And I would like to focus on the issue how we can integrate and with management and how we can use already existing tools to move from our human-centered sustainability or human-centered economics to the real life. Okay, and so let me skip Adam Smith's definition. We didn't talk today, however, about Alfred Marshall, the father, founding father of neoclassical economics, who wanted to get rid of political economy and then have pure hard science, objective. Unfortunately, as we see the results, it was not fully successful attempts, you know, because there are some assumptions behind which are value-driven. I'm a practitioner. My date with economics is over 50 years old as a student and then 48 years as an academic person teaching economics, different schools of economics, because I was born and educated in Poland. Thanks God we had not only Marxist economics, but we were allowed to study also classical, neoclassical, even some institutional economics. I mean, Poland and Hungary were much more open. So I defined economics, and then I spent on my particularly on my PhD a lot of study on mathematical economics, mainly the Soviets. I don't want to say only Russians, because there were some also Ukrainian great mathematicians and contributors to economics. So from that point of view, I defined economics as one of the hardest social sciences, searching for optimal allocation of resources, all different forms of capital we discussed today, to satisfy human needs and secure human-centered sustainability. Sustainability includes also the security and the safety and so all these elements. It takes into account all four stages of reproduction, not just production or exchange, but also distribution and consumption. As I mentioned, we didn't discuss much about consumption, we complained. All of these stages are equally important, because this is the subject of economics, how we consume, what we consume, because it has an impact, both economic impact, environmental impact, and social impact. But this is the hard stuff, and many economists and don't want to deal with this issue. We discussed already this issue, but I want to be sure that we have this positive and normative sides of economics. Neoclassical is doing mainly with a positive side. I'm closely related now to microeconomics. We try to focus on the facts. However, microeconomics, in the way we are, I will be talking a little bit later who we are using applied economics approach. So we had to use also some normative stuff, prepare from our analysis, prepare policy recommendations. So we are responding to the question, what ought to be. So, in general, if we look at the economics, we are dealing with the substance. But we do not talk how to reach the goal. And this is how to reach sustainable, human-centered sustainable development or human-centered sustainability. This is why economics needs management. which should show us the way how to reach and show the what process we should follow. Management for me is the process to undertake by one or individuals to coordinate other activities to reach results which otherwise won't be able to achieve. I follow the definition of one of the most popular management books by Donnelly and team. But, I mean, as the discipline started emerging at the beginning of 20th century, mainly among engineers, practitioners, started that type of scientific management, and then became to introduce some scientific rigors to the research. However, the first principles of management was formulated by the whole company manager, Henri Fayol. I don't know whether my... Henri Fayol. Thank you, Grażyna. In 1929. So, contemporary guru of management, Peter Drucker, described management as making people productive, competent, integrated, and performing. I think that all words, all adjectives are here very important. What management is about? Well, management utilizes disciplines, utilize knowledge of many disciplines, including psychologists, sociology, statistics, social anthropology, as well as economics, many branches, and then the one branch which integrates all those from principal management, resource management, or accounting, financial management, is strategic management. And this is what I would like to focus on, the interface between microeconomics and strategic management. Okay. I can mention already. And then the issue is, if we are talking about strategic management, and we are talking to the way to sustainability, we should look, you know, who controls the majority of resources? Who is in control? Because otherwise, if we do not address which part, who controls, and how those who control should move to human-centered sustainability, we will be missing our recommendations, our conclusions. So if we look at the revenues base, for instance, 60, 70 to 80% controls by business, by companies, by corporations. So this is why, you know, we need, you know, I have here the slide, I will come back later, showing the statistics from the States. But so microeconomics, I started with my PhD with microeconomics, focused on the lowest level, on the firm, households, and government level as a core knowledge for material wealth, to create material wealth there, and how to how products and services are exchanged and revenues distributed at the first stage, you know, because there is a second distribution to the government, the taxation, and so on. Okay, what economists should fix first before we will talk about sustainable business? I have already mentioned the major stakeholder of sustainability, of human-centered sustainability, companies. But we need to define human-centered sustainability. What does it mean? Well, there are many definitions. We talk here in the previous workshops how to define. But in general, for human beings, means to carry out the carrying capacity, to keep, maintain non-declining carrying capacity. This well to secure wealth and reproduction. So we have these two major factors need to take into account: the limitations of resources and securing intergenerational equity. We didn't discuss much about this issue yesterday and today, and this is very important when we are talking about sustainability. In economics, we have two basic approaches. One, the most popular, is maximizing material wealth. But there is also, I mean, since the 70s, different approach initiated by Robert Solow, followed by John Hartwig, telling that we don't need maximizing material wealth because it's hard to define due to cultural differences, religion, ethnic issue. But we can secure this without defining what is in the basket, basic basket, what we need to secure, if we will keep non-declining total capital. So, and then there is a small, I guess, 12 or 15 pages, one of the most popular article in economics by John Hartwig, who is showing mathematically that constant level of consumption could be secured if we reinvest the rents of capital. So, I mean, this is something what, you know, it's equally important, and I prefer, for several reasons, grow up on a farm, and I learned the concept on non-declining capital. My grandfather told me, hey, my grandson, our task is to leave the farm in better shape than we inherited. This is exactly what we should leave the next generation. The earth, the economic, social system, in better shape than we inherited. So, and why, if you look at the fact, you presented many facts, but I think that based on non-material wealth, on GDP, contribute to huge distributional gap, dominance of material private goods, discrimination of investment in non-material capital and public goods, and so on. You are talking about most of these issues which are mentioned here. Erosion of ethical value, discrimination and investment in non-material capital, uncontrolled degradation, and degradation of public trust, and so on. But neither market regulation or centrally planned regulation didn't give us good solutions. So maybe we should look for alternative solution, and I am proposing, since I guess our meeting in Podgorica, and I was so happy to hear from our colleague Radmilo from Belgrade, that networking is the way which will fill the gap or could correct some of the deficiencies of market and regulations, or we know several of us what the type of regulation is. This, I showed the equations, so this is the practical, some improvement of GDP, the net adjusted savings. But I would like to show up briefly, maybe tomorrow we might have more time to talk in evolution economics session. That non-maintaining, non-declining total capital is much better approach because it can present better balance between material and non-material forms of capital. Shows incentives to human capital, which has unlimited creativity, encourage investment in social capital, which is critical for business and public life. and somehow based on ethical principles and shared norms and trust, and including altruism, compassion and mercy, yeah. And then this would be a significant shift, a contribution to the paradigm shift in economics with human-centered sustainability. This is the formula, very simple formula we presented, I guess, 2005. I was inspired by David Pearce, to work for the World Bank Environmental Resource Economics Groups in the 90s. And he presented the four types of capital. We added here without social capital. And we added here the social capital. And at this stage, I divided capital into four major groups. Five types of capital, two major groups, material capital, physical, financial, and human and social capital. And within physical capital, I separated natural capital from man-made. And this approach is supported by other scholars. This is the Sigma Project, taken from Dan's book, you know. I mean, it's a popular MIT project. And then we were also in the discussion with our colleague Joachim Spangenberg, who showed the picture of sustainability, and he added to traditional triple bottom line the fourth component, the institutional imperative. So, and then if we look, you know, what's going on in Poland, Hungary, in US, in Turkey, we see how important is the institutional imperative, you know, so to strengthen democracy, strengthen justice system and care and all these elements which are associated with social capital, human capital, in general, non-material capital. Okay, and then, you know, this is why I presented this stuff, you know, I defined human capital as OECD, but in Greek this is the single creative capital, the most important. But social capital is a special type of capital. I define this way, this is the social capital is the result of investment in building relations. This is what we are doing here. We are building relations. The longer we stay, the more trust we have. Trust is the result of the benefit of social capital. So we're building relations, we're building institutions, because the institutions are, first of all, rules, standards, you know, the shared values, and which produce collaborative attitude and mutual understanding and trust. These are the critical elements for sustainability. But we should keep in mind that we have not only positive but also negative social capital. When system is getting close, when networks are getting exclusive, you know, so the negative capital is emerging. And we need to be aware and fight with this. This is why openness and transparency is very important to secure our investment in relations. Okay, I work on measuring this, in general, counting the time invested in developing relations. We use simple methods, two methods, survey methods and accounting methods. We practice this. I had a project on clustering. By the way, clustering is a form of network. We were using, you know, how the clusters correct the market decisions, you know. So when we are looking at the major stakeholders, I want to focus on three groups: companies, NGOs, and academia. And this is what I was looking for, the real power of business. 23 trillion, I mean it's 2013, is estimated total corporate revenues. Government had only 3 trillion, so you see the proportions. who control why and the distribution, and non-governmental organization 1.2. This is the picture of the from the largest so far economy, but it should show us the target, you know, where we should address our issues, to whom. Okay, so we need to call for responsible action. Academia, we need to start from ourselves. Okay, good. And then in education process, we need to practice student-centered approach and pick up, discover, help to discover unique talents. We need to, I will talk more about human capital later on, but in terms of academia, so we developed, it's 15 years old, the program Microeconomics of Competitiveness, which is now the knowledge generation network on clusters, innovations, came out from Harvard Business School, from Michael Porter. So from this point of view, sustainable business means maintaining competitive advantage from unique value chain. So it required a strategic approach. And this is what I was asking, how do you understand the competition, competitiveness, or doesn't mean? Unfortunately, most of the people are defining competition as the lower cost, you know. This is wrong approach if we want to reach the human wealth, and then, you know, we need to focus on product differentiations and then produce the unique value for consumers. And this unique value should not only have economic value, but it should include environmental value, social values. So, for instance, this is the example of the major invention of Michael Porter, the value chain. We can design value chain this way to put these values to the program. So, for instance, financial reporting, good governance practice, then, you know, product environmental impact we should include in designing. So there are 9 elements of this, the basic and supportive, and in which if we will take procurement on the, let's say, procurement practices, we will pay the fair prices. So, anyway, and the impact of transportation in terms of logistics. So, if we look in the recycling, if we will respect equal opportunities, no discrimination in hiring. So you have all elements, all values we're talking, you can include to your value chain. This is a very important, powerful tool. This is why we need to learn management, economics, because if company is claiming, hey, we are green or we are sustainable company, I say, okay, show me your value chain, and then, okay, we have another, tool, you know, type of diamond of competition. We have also similar elements, you know, what elements are the company based, the development. And then the final, we should look, you know, whether the company is creating shared value. And this is something what company can do, I mean, what company could look, you know, for employee skills as a business opportunity, worker safety, and so on. Not as charitable activities, but approach to as business, showing the product is expanding the value, because we are offering not only good products, effective, but our workers are safe. We are minimizing environmental impact. We give suppliers fair access. We save water, we conserve energy. So anyway, this way we can support what Dan was talking, to move companies from the second stage, compliance stage, to third, beyond compliance and integrated strategy and so on. This way, so we have the already managerial tools, and what is at the stake? This is already the size of environmental market. it's not just for environmental films, but all those which are producing environmental friendly and social products, it's over $2 trillion. This is more than the Indian economy. So think about that, and then we need to work. Thank you very much.